God's house. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We are so thankful and grateful you have joined us this morning. It's a special Sunday. It's a Sunday right after the closest Sunday to Veterans Day. And so we want to take a moment this morning and honor all of those who have served our country. And so if you've ever served in any of the branches of the military, would you please stand up so we will recognize you? Please remain standing for a moment. Thank you, thank you. Because we have a special little gift for you our kids are going to hand out. Once you receive the gift, will you go ahead and please sit down for a moment? Hello. Once you receive a bag, go ahead and sit down. If you have an extra one, go ahead and bring it back up front. Miss Beth.
Yay.
Thank you, thank you. Veterans, one more time, you're going to get your exercise this morning. Would you please stand so that we might pray for you this morning? It is great and a wonderful thing that we have such a wonderful country. And wonderful men and women who have served this country faithfully. And this world would not be what it is today without the sacrifice and service of the men and women here and across this great country and all over the world that are now serving. Let's pray for them. Let's pray and continue to pray for them and for their families. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you, Father, that we live in a country where we are free to gather together and to worship you. And we can do so without fear of reprisal, without fear of persecution. And that is because of men and women who have served this country and who have served and fought for justice and for freedom and who continue to fight for that all over the world. Father, we thank you for these men and women and for their service, for many of them who have sacrificed the great sacrifice by laying down their lives. And your word has told us there is no greater love to lay down your life for a friend. Father, we pray that you would bless them and that you would put a hedge of protection around them and their families. And Lord, that you would lift them up and you continue to lead them according to your word. Father, we thank you for those here in our own church who have served. We thank you, Lord, for the lives that they have lived and continue to live in obedience and sacrifice and service. Father, I pray that you would use them in a mighty and powerful way to continue to make a difference in building your kingdom. Father, we thank you for their sacrifice, their service, and for all those who are continuing to serve. Watch over them, Father, and lead them by your word. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. One more time. We are so very thankful for your service. Be seated. Just kidding. Everybody, stand up. We're going to worship now.
Yeah.
find your way to your seats. Just want to draw your attention to the bosses we have over here. Of course, we do this every year. It's Operation Christmas Child. Each one of these boxes is going to be sent around the world to a child that this will be the only gift they get. Now, the beautiful thing about these boxes is not that it's filled with toys and toothbrushes and socks and stuffed animals and things that a child needs or wants. The beautiful thing is that this box also comes with a presentation of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So the beautiful thing is, while we can sit here in our comfortable homes and in the wonderful country we live in, we get to be a part and join together with missionaries all over the world who are declaring the gospel to those in the darkest and most farthest reaches of this world. And we get to join them by doing this. If you didn't get a chance to get your box in today, you can still bring it by the church. Please have it here by Wednesday. So please come drop it off Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday, and we'll get those turned in. We do want to take a moment and pray over these boxes, that God would use these in the lives of not just the children's hands that they enter in, but their families as well. Many times a child will come to Christ because of this and then take the gospel back to their families. It's a wonderful and beautiful way that we get to be a part of this beautiful ministry. Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you, Father, for how you've blessed us in so, so many ways. And Father, we pray that we would always be good stewards of everything that you have given us. And Father, I pray that as we take just a portion of what you've blessed us with and then turn it into a box, that these boxes would find their hands, find their way into these hands of these beautiful children whose hearts and minds you've already begun to prepare, that they might hear the hope that is in Jesus Christ, that they might know why we celebrate Christmas and the greatest gift that this world has ever received, your Son, Jesus. Father, I pray that through the missionaries that use them, through the ministry of the Franklin Graham of Samaritan Purse, you would use these boxes in a mighty and powerful way to spread the good news of Jesus all over this world. Thank you for this opportunity that we get to join in and being a part of that ministry. Father, bless these boxes. Bless the hands and the workers of the Samaritan's Purse. Bless the hands of the little children that will receive them and open their hearts to hear about Jesus. Thank you, Father, for how you've blessed us. And may we always turn that into blessing others. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I'm going to have Micah come and give the announcements. While he's coming up, I just want to mention that the men's cowboy breakfast is this Saturday. We're going to have a lot of good food here. We're going to have eggs, bacon, sausage, we'll have water, orange juice, biscuits, homemade tortillas. Let me tell you, that right there is worth it. Coffee and horseshoes. Now, you can come and try your hand at horseshoes, but we already know who the winners are. That's right. That's right. It has already been determined. It's predestined who those winners are, and you know who they are. And if you don't, come find out on Saturday. Please, if you're going to come join us, bring a lawn chair so you have a spot to sit in. There are some seats, but not enough for everybody. And that's going to be this Saturday. If it is raining, if it's raining at all, we're going to cancel it and we'll just have it at Soul Day Police Goes like we usually do. So while we need the rain, pray for rain, but pray that it doesn't rain Saturday so we can have a wonderful time with fellowship at the Cowboy Breakfast.
Alright, today there's committee meetings following the morning worship service, a church council meeting at 4 p.m. Book study at the Franks at 5:30 p.m. tonight. And coming up, the senior adult lunch Thursday, November 16th. And as Brother Jeremy said, the cowboy breakfast Saturday, November 18th. At the Gomez's, not at Soda East Goes, and let him know if you're coming, so we have extra bacon. the Thanksgiving potluck lunch is next Sunday after morning worship, and we will decorate the church for Christmas afterwards, and here's your scripture reading now.
Good morning. Can I ask you to stand with me for reading the Lord's Word? And this is love, that we walk according to His commandments. This is the commandment, just as you have heard from the beginning, so that you should walk in it. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you for allowing us to come to your house today. We thank you that so little green is showing up in this church pews this evening. Lord, we just ask that you would be with those in Israel, those that need our prayers. Lord, guide them, keep them safe. Lord, thank you for blessing us in so many numerous ways. I also ask that you would continue to help these boxes to spread your word. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Bless you, Lord. Good morning.
Good morning.
Pray with me, please. Our Father, which art in heaven, please bless this offering so that it be used to grow thy church and help this community, and bless your nation of Israel in her time of need. Please bring revival back to this nation so it can be what you designed it to be again. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Mature in the Lord. Another sign of maturity in someone is wisdom. So I wanted to talk about this morning being wise. Let's be wise. Not a wise guy, but someone who has wisdom. There's plenty of wise guys out there. We might have a few here in the crowd this morning. We have a few less. My family is not here. My wife was going with the kids to go to our family, one of her sister's churches, because our nephew is getting baptized this morning. Yes, wonderful, wonderful thing to celebrate. But we're come this morning, and the implication here is that we need wisdom.
Amen.
How many of you have ever made an unwise decision before? Yeah? They're not fun, are they?
No.
They come with repercussions. They come with consequences.
Yes.
We don't like making them. Of course, I don't know anyone who enjoys making mistakes. We're going to look in Proverbs, so if you want to go ahead and turn there. We're going to be in Proverbs chapter 2. Now, Proverbs was written by Solomon, and Solomon is described in 1 Kings chapter 3 as the wisest person that has ever lived or ever will be. Of course, God came and asked him, what do you want? And he could have asked for anything. He could have asked for wealth or riches or women or fame or power. He didn't ask for any of those. He asked for discernment and for wisdom. And God said, because you asked for wisdom and to follow my word, I will give you all these other things. So we know Solomon is a very wise man, and he wrote Proverbs, and it's called the Book of Wisdom. You've heard the adage before, an apple a day keeps the
doctor away.
So there's the other adage, a proverb a day keeps the
doctor away.
I wish that were true. I wish all we had to do was read Proverbs in the morning, and we would be set for the rest of our day. But I promise you, that if you dig into Proverbs, and you read some Proverbs every day, you're going to be a little wiser. Now, let's dive into our passage this morning. Please stand if you will. Proverbs chapter 2, we're going to look at the first 10 verses. Solomon writes, "My son, if you accept my words and store up my commands within you, listening closely to wisdom and directing your heart to understanding, furthermore, if you call out to insight and lift your voice to understanding, if you seek it like silver and search for it like hidden treasure, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and discover the knowledge of God. For the Lord gives wisdom. From his mouth come knowledge and understanding. He stores up success for the upright. He is a shield for those who live with integrity, so that he may guard the paths of justice and protect the way of his loyal followers. Then you will understand righteousness, justice, and integrity, every good path. For wisdom will enter your mind, and knowledge will delight your heart." Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, I come before you and admit, Father, I am not as smart or as wise as I need to be. And Father, I thank you for your word, how it edifies us, how it challenges us, how it grows us. And yes, Lord, when we need it, how it convicts us. I pray, Father, you would speak to us through your word, and you would, through your Holy Spirit, give us the ability and the power to understand the things of God. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for your son. Thank you for your word. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Now, just a quick poll, show of hands. How many of you would say, I'm as wise as I've ever been and I don't need to be any wiser? All right, you've already made a wise decision not to raise your hand. Because a wise person would never say that. No matter where you are, you can learn more. You can grow more. You can mature more. You can become more wise. And we need wisdom. Very quickly, let's take a step back and ask the question, what is wisdom? There's different kinds of wisdom, aren't there?
In fact, many people in this world would say that they are wise, and of the things of the world, they are very wise. There are people far greater than I who know how to make money, or who know how to build a business, or how to grow a following. There are a lot of people who know a lot of things, and if you're judging things by the attributes of the world, there are a lot of great and wise people out there. But is that true wisdom? Well, I would say yes and no. Yes, it is in the sense of a worldly sense, but no, not in the sense of an eternal and divine sense. We find what true wisdom is in the book of wisdom, Proverbs. Look at the verse chapter, if you will. Verse 7, he says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction." So we find the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. We don't want to be a fool, do we? Does anybody want to be a fool? To delight in being foolish? No. We don't want to feel stupid. We don't want to feel like we don't understand something. We want to be mature. We want to be wise. It begins with fearing the Lord. Now, this fear that it speaks of is not like I'm afraid, but more of a fatherly fear. You have a reverence. You have a respect for your parents. You wouldn't openly do something that was wrong if your father was in the room, would you? Hopefully not, because you have a fear of him, a reverence of him. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Solomon goes on to say in chapter 9, he expounds on this, verse 10, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and knowledge of the Holy One is understanding." So we find our understanding, the beginning, the foundation, is having a reverence for the Lord, and knowledge comes from Him, the Holy One. Now, if you want a clearer understanding of what the fear of the Lord is, look at chapter 8, verse 13. He says, "To fear the Lord is to hate evil." See, this is a problem in our world. We have so many people who are running around claiming to be Christians, claiming to be believers in Christ, but the evidence is not there in their life. We can run around and we can say, "Yes, I have a fear of the Lord," but if we are delighting in evil, if we are rejoicing in what is wrong and what is sinful, then we have found ourselves to be liars. True wisdom comes from the Lord. Jesus put it in a wonderful parable that we understand, Matthew chapter 7, if you want to turn there for a moment, beginning in verse 24. You probably have learned it as a child singing the song. How many of you know the song, "The wise man built his house upon the
rock"?
I'm not going to attempt to sing it for you. If I had given me more forethought, I would have asked Jeremiah to memorize it and come up here and sing it for us. He has a much better voice than I. But you all know it. "The wise man built his house upon the rock." Wise man built his house upon the rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock, and the rains came down. The rains came down, and the floods came up. The rains came down, and the floods came up. The rains came down, and the floods came up. And the house on the rock stood firm. The foolish man built his house upon the
sand.
The foolish man built his house upon the sand. The foolish man built his house upon the sand, and the rains came down. The rains came down, and the floods came up. The rains came down, and the floods came up. The rains came down, and the floods came up, and the house on the sand fell flat. Or splat. So build your house on the Lord Jesus Christ. So build your house on the Lord Jesus Christ. So build your house on the Lord Jesus Christ, and the blessings will flow down. The blessings come down and the prayers come up. The blessings come down and the prayers come up. The blessings come down and the prayers go up. And so build your house on the Lord. At a moment there where I almost forgot the very last line of the song, Thank y'all for helping me with that. Well, let's see what the actual passage says. This is in Matthew chapter 7. This is Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, the most amazing and beautiful sermon. And if there's anyone who is wiser than Solomon, it is, of course, Jesus Christ. And Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7, verse 24, "Therefore, anyone who hears these words of mine and acts on them will be like a sensible or wise man who built his house on the rock." So what is it that is the rock? What is it that we build our house on, we build our life on? It is the words of Christ. It is God's word, his holy scripture, the Bible. That is what we build our house on. The rain fell, the rivers rose, the winds blew and pounded that house, yet it didn't collapse because its foundation was on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and doesn't act on them will be like a foolish man who has built his house on the sand. The rain fell, and the rivers rose, and the winds blew and pounded that house, and it collapsed. And its collapse was great. When Jesus had finished this sermon, the crowds were astonished at his teaching, because he was teaching them like one who had authority, not like the scribes. So we see from this passage that Jesus very clearly outlines what true wisdom is. True wisdom is building our life upon the rock, the bedrock of God's word. Life, there's plenty of storms. How many of you have been through a storm in your life? And I don't mean rain or thunder or lightning. I mean those things that come crashing down that shake you to your core. The rain comes down, the rivers rise, the wind blows, and it pounds on the house of our hearts. And if you've built your house on the things of the world, if you've built your house on the promise of the American dream, you have built it on something that is not rock, but shifting sand. And when the things of the world come in, and the storms come, and the winds blow, and they pound on that house, it will fall. You build your house on God's word, you will find that nothing can bring that house down. Doesn't mean it doesn't get scary, doesn't mean that it doesn't hurt, it doesn't mean that the rains stop, but it means that we stand on the truth of his word and nothing will ever take that away. True wisdom is God's word. We find it right here in our hands. You have it. And yet, so many times, we take it for granted, don't we? This is what true wisdom is. Second question. So how do we obtain wisdom? It's not enough that we know what wisdom is. We need to understand how we obtain wisdom, how we grow in our wisdom. Now, there's a couple of prerequisites for gaining wisdom that we find here in this passage in Proverbs chapter 2. The first is that we have to desire wisdom. Solomon says, "Listen closely, direct your hearts, call out to it, lift up your voice." You see, there's this desire to have wisdom. There's no point in telling someone 21 ways of how to lose weight if they don't, in fact, want to lose weight, do they? Furthermore, actually, most of us understand how to lose weight. We have the knowledge, so what's the problem? We don't have the desire. We are not motivated enough to do something. So if we're going to grow in wisdom, we have to desire wisdom. We have to understand its importance. We have to understand how wonderful it is. Secondly, we have to have humility. Verse 1, he says, "My son, if you accept my words and store up my commands within you." That takes humility. Has anyone ever told you something you immediately disregarded? Absolutely. Absolutely. Because you didn't either respect them or believe them or know it to be true. Or it might have been just pride in your heart. There's many reasons why we aren't humble. There's many reasons we don't accept instruction. But when it comes to true wisdom, when it comes to God's word, a prerequisite is that we have a humble heart.
Because the truth of the matter is, there's no case that you can bring to the Lord where you are right and He is wrong. If that were true, He wouldn't be God. The best we can ever do is come before the Lord and agree with Him and say, yes, God, you know what? You are right, and I am wrong. So the two prerequisites we see here for gaining wisdom are that we have to have the desire for wisdom, and we have to have the humility to receive that wisdom. My son, if you accept my words, if you store up my commands within you, if you don't, there's no point. In fact, if you don't want to grow in wisdom, if you don't want to grow in the Lord, if you don't want to grow in your relationship with Christ, there's no point in being here this morning. You might as well get up and leave. Thank you that no one left. I appreciate that. We have to have these prerequisites. Otherwise, we are not going to grow in wisdom. So let me give you a few ways that we grow in wisdom. First that we see here in this passage is that we seek it. He says, verse 4, if you seek it like silver and search for it like hidden treasure. Now this sounds repetitive, almost like the prerequisite of desiring it. And they are connected. Nothing is ever clear cut. It's always this mess and jumble of things and connected. Life is very messy. We have to first have the desire to do something. To use the example of losing weight. We have to have that desire to lose weight. But if we stay on the couch, then it's kind of pointless. If we keep eating chips and donuts and cookies, then it's kind of pointless. We have to put down the chips, we have to get off the couch, and we have to say, yep, I want to lose weight, so I'm going to get up and I'm going to go exercise. If we sit here this morning and we say, man, you know, I sure would like to grow in wisdom. I would like to be more wise according to God's word. But then we walk out those doors and we haven't changed anything in our life, then we're doing the same thing. Desire must lead to action, to taking those steps forward. Otherwise, we're just going to be in the same place that we've always been. So we have to seek it. We have to step out and look for wisdom. To obtain wisdom, we must seek it. We must work for it. We must apply these principles and dive deep into God's word and to live a life pursuant of the gospel. That's why Solomon said in verse 4, if you seek it like silver. How does he say we are to seek it? Like silver, like hidden treasure. We're to seek after wisdom in the same way we would if I told you there was millions of dollars in gold buried out in our playground. There's not. Please don't go tear up our playground. But if I told you that this morning, I'm sure that more than one of us would run home, get a shovel, jump out there, and begin digging holes all over the place. Is that how we seek wisdom? Do we go home? Do we grab our Bibles? Do we grab the shovels of our mind and we begin to mine out the wisdom that we find in His Word? That's how we seek it, like it's a treasure, and it is. We will never grow in wisdom if we are not seeking wisdom. Beautiful and wonderful treasure that we have right here in our fingertips. The average Christian will pick up their Bibles and bring them to church, go home, set it down, and not pick it up again until next Sunday morning. We must seek wisdom. Secondly, we must find it in Scripture. That should be evident at this point. This shouldn't be any kind of information that just blows you out of the water. But it is a great reminder to us this morning. We find true wisdom in God's Word. So how much time are we spending in God's Word? Kids nowadays will play video games, and my kids play video games, and I've played video games, and I'm guilty of it, but the amount of time that we spend in video games or other recreation things pales in comparison to how many times we dig into God's Word. Our priorities in life might be off. We might be at a place where we need to re-examine what we are doing
in our life. Solomon continues. He says, if you seek it like silver and you search for it like hidden treasure, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and discover the knowledge of God. And where do we find it? Verse 6. For the Lord God gives wisdom. From his mouth come understanding, come knowledge and understanding. We find true wisdom in the Bible. Yet with all the resources we have today, yet with all the sermons that are online, all the great, wonderful preachers out there that you can pull up a number of resources, all the Bible studies that we have at our fingertips, we have never been as biblically illiterate as we are today. We know the Bible less than when we did 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago. That is a travesty. We have got to get into God's Word. Because only from Him comes wisdom. From His mouth come knowledge and understanding. We find it in His Word. And you don't have to do it alone. There are some passages that are difficult. There are passages that are hard. The thing I learned when I went to seminary was just how much I didn't know. We continue to grow in our walk. We continue to learn. We continue to mature. We continue to become more wise. But that doesn't happen unless we have personal, private time of getting into God's Word. Bring your questions. Bring your thoughts. Bring your concerns. And find someone in your life that you know, that you look up to. And ask them. Get together with someone and begin a discipleship journey with them. Come and join us for Sunday school. We have some great Sunday school teachers. It might be a little weird, but they are great Sunday school teachers. I'm kidding. And it's a great time to gather together with fellow brothers and sisters and get into God's Word and to sink your teeth in it. In fact, I want to make you a challenge. If you've never come to Sunday school before here at our church, if you're a guest or a visitor or just a longtime member, I want to challenge you. Next Sunday, come and join us for Sunday school. We have a Sunday school class for every single one of you, for all age groups, for every dynamic and demographic of people. We have a Sunday school for you. So if you've never done that, wake up just a little bit early. Our Sunday school starts at 9:15. If that's rough for you, we'll have coffee ready for you. And come join us for Sunday school. Gather together with your brothers and your sisters and dig into God's Word. If we're going to grow in wisdom, we have to seek it. We have to find it in Scripture. But we also have to walk in it. You see, wisdom is more than just garnering knowledge. Growing in factual things that we know. It's the application of that knowledge that results in action and movement. It's not enough to know and be able to identify all the tools in the toolbox. You have to know how to use them properly, right? Now we can sum up what that looks like in one word. Obedience. Obedience. We will not grow in wisdom if we don't walk according to God's Word, if we don't listen to what He has told us already. Verse 7, He says, He stores up success for who? The upright. He is a shield for those who live with what? Integrity. So that He may guard the paths of justice and protect the way of His loyal followers. These are examples of people who are listening to the Lord, who are growing in their relationship with Him and who are trusting Him enough that they're going to follow His instructions, listen to His commands. You don't grow unless you do. Now, I'm not a huge sports fan in the realm of watching sports, but I've always enjoyed playing sports. If you go and you learn all the principles of, let's say, basketball, And let's say you look up all the different drills you could ever possibly do in basketball. And let's say you watch videos of all the things that the pros do in their practices. Let's say you go back and you watch all the highlights of the incredible men and women who've played basketball. Let's say you watch Michael Jordan and you've seen his documentary and you know everything about him. But you never pick up a basketball. How well are you going to do when you step on the court? Not very well. We have to walk in the gospel. We have to obey what God has told us. We have to practice what we preach. Because after we do this, After we've sought the Lord and we find the truth in His Scripture, and after we apply it to our life, it says in verse 9, then you will understand righteousness and justice and integrity, every good path. Because there's laying before you a fork in the road. And you get to choose whether you're going to go to the right or to the left. You get to choose whether you're going to listen and follow God's word or you're going to disregard God's word. That's why Solomon goes on and says in verse 11, discretion will watch over you and understanding will guard you. We need this. Rescuing you from the way of evil, from those who say perverse things, from those who abandon the right paths to walk in ways of darkness. If we're going to grow in wisdom, then we have to apply that wisdom. We have to apply God's word to our life. Otherwise, we're walking on the path of darkness that does not lead to growth in Christ, does not lead to maturity, does not lead to wisdom. If you want to grow in wisdom, seek it, find it in Scripture, and then walk in it. Obey what God has called us to. Next, we are to delight in it. Verse 10, for wisdom will enter your mind, and knowledge will delight your heart. We are to delight in the Lord. And when we do so, He gives us the desires of our heart. So similarly, we are to delight in God's word. We are to delight in wisdom. And when we do, we grow in that. Do you remember picking up a new hobby or a new sport? And you enjoy it? You begin to practice, you begin to study, you begin to try all the things to be better at it. Our daughter plays the flutes, and we're so glad that she has joined band in school because she found something that she enjoys. Whereas when she comes home, we have to get on to her about doing her math homework on time or working on history or social studies. We don't have to talk to her about practicing with the flute because she goes upstairs and she practices. She enjoys it. We enjoy the wisdom of God. One of the best ways we can do that is to look at what God has done in our life. To see His good and magnificent works throughout Scripture. The more that we see the beauty and the majesty of the Lord, the more that we're going to delight in Him. Just as we look at our spouse, the more that we find them beautiful, the more we're attracted, the more we delight in them. Same with the Lord. The more time you spend with the Lord, the more time you dive into what He has done, truly done for you. There's nothing I could ever do that will ever really bring me to the point that I fully comprehend the amount of sin that I have committed in my life. Which means that every time I grow in my understanding of just how truly despicable I have been, I also grow in truly seeing how wonderful and gracious and merciful God is. If we're going to grow in wisdom, we must delight in wisdom. And lastly, this isn't in our passage here, but I would definitely say that Solomon would agree with this. We'll look at another verse for it. We should pray for it. We should pray for it. James chapter 1, verse 5. James tells us, if any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives to all generously, without criticizing, and it will be given to him. We have an open invitation to come to the one who has the greatest wealth and riches of knowledge and wisdom, of grace and mercy. How often we pass on that invitation. God is calling us to commune with him. God is calling us to bring our prayers to him. And even when we are lacking in understanding and knowledge and wisdom, God says, bring it to me. Jeremiah 33:3 says, ask and I will tell you great and unsearchable things you do not know. Ask. God is waiting for us to come before his throne and to ask. Now there's this beautiful promise that we have. When we come and we come in faith, God hears those prayers and God answers generously. Now don't make the mistake in thinking that all you have to do is pray. Don't walk out this door this morning and say, the only thing I need to grow in wisdom is to ask the Lord for it. Because clearly his word calls us not just to ask for it, and God gives generously, but God also calls us to work for it as well. We pray for it and we work towards it. We work out what God has already put in. Paul, the way he said it to Timothy, his disciple, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15. He said, be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, correctly handling the word of truth. If you want to grow in wisdom, this is it. You have to desire it. You have to have a humble heart. You have to know that when you come to God's word, he's going to reveal things in your life that you haven't turned over to him. He's going to show you where you have been wrong and he is right. And we have to believe him. We have to trust him. We have to have faith that his way is right. And our way is never right. We must seek it. We must find it in Scripture. We must walk in it in obedience. We must delight in it. And we must seek him in prayer. If you're lacking in wisdom this morning, as I am, then we need to apply this truth, to stand on the gospel, to seek it out, to study it, to sink our teeth in it, and to grow in it. And if you walk out these doors and nothing changes about your life, that this week is exactly like last week, then you're going to find yourself back here on Sunday morning no wiser than you are today. And I'm not trying to be negative here. I'm just telling you honestly. I've sat on the couch. I've continued to eat potato chips. And I found myself actually heavier than when I was. We're going to grow. We're going to be mature. And we're going to be wise. We've got to get into God's Word. Never done that? Pick up your Bible this week. I'm not asking you to spend the first 3, 4, 5, 6 hours of your day in God's Word. Spend 15 minutes. Begin with Ephesians or John or James. Take it a few verses at a time. Read the passage. Ponder it. Meditate on it. Pray for the Lord to help you to understand it. God has given us this beautiful gift of the Holy Spirit who leads us and guides us in our understanding. And if you have a question, that's okay. You don't have to feel stupid, because I guarantee you, I have been more stupider than anyone. Bring your questions. Come join us next Sunday morning for Sunday school. And find there are people just like you. And God has given us brothers and sisters. How wise are you this morning? We want to give you a chance to respond. Please stand if you will. The altar's open if you'd like to come and pray. If you'd like for me to pray with you, I'd love to. But you come as He calls. Please get them here by Wednesday, and we'll get those turned in. Man, if you're joining us for the breakfast, if you give us a heads up so that we know how many to expect. Also, don't forget to bring a lawn chair so you have a place to sit. If it is raining, we will not have it out there. We will be at Sol de Jalisco's. Next Sunday is our Thanksgiving lunch, and everybody said?
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. We love to eat. That's why we're Baptists. Well, okay, we get the name for other reasons than just eating. But we do enjoy eating. So if you are bringing a dish, please make sure you sign up on the list outside so we know what you're bringing and you can see what other people are bringing so we don't have too much of something. There are never enough desserts. Just want to point that out there. So feel free to bring a dessert no matter what. Let's grab a hand across the aisle and be dismissed this morning.
We're gonna sing, I've got peace, love, and joy like a river.
I've got peace, love, and joy like a river.